All right, so in this talk, I'm going to present some results that I showed during the summer in practice and experience in research computing. The audience of that conference is mostly people from different areas. They use supercomputers to process all sorts of scientific research. So the reason why we presented in that paper, we submitted that conference, sorry, is because a lot of the times the problem is not, even though you buy some equipment and you have some memory infrastructure in place to do this processing, you are limited by the data transfer tools that you use to move data from one place to another, or also some rate limiting policies in the case when you use cloud service providers. So, first of all, let's start thinking on how the data is nowadays generated. So we have multiple disciplines. Now, like once upon a time, it was just a niche of the discipline, but nowadays, like every single discipline is generating a lot of data. Some of this data is generated locally in your laptop, in a desktop machine in the laboratory, also in a dedicated server that is also part of your building, your college. Could be generated in the supercomputer or also on the cloud. The problem is that not necessarily where you generate the data is where the data will be processed. Oftentimes you have to share the data. Even if you are in a collaborative research, it's very likely you need to share data with your other investigators. So then moving the data is becoming the bottleneck of your workflow. And in this talk, I'm going to focus on the impact that data transfer tools have in those transmissions and how the users need to be aware of certain factors to maximize their performance. So let's take a look at the factors that affect the data transfer. Like a normal data transfer, you are uploading data to any place. Turns out there are a lot of them, like impossible to put them all together in one slide, but these are the ones that we were focusing mostly on. So, as I said, the tool, and then for each tool, you have a different set of parameters. So, depending on how flexible the tool is, it's more complex to use, but it allows you to tailor the application to take advantage of your machine. Also, where are you located? Are you deep in the campus network? Are you at the edge of the campus network? How powerful is your computer, like the specifications of the systems, how is your data set? Is it just one big file, 101 terabyte file, or is it just 1 million 1K files? So all those things come into place all together to determine how good or bad you perform when moving data. So what we did, because some of our we developed some software to manipulate some of the devices in our campus network, and we were not getting the performance that we were expecting. So we had this 10 gig server, and we were getting way below 1 gig performance. So to some sites, we were getting faster. So we tried to identify what was happening and why. When I was running experiments, I was getting certain speed, but when my colleague was running another experiment, he was getting another one. So that yielded a lot of discussions, and I think that finally we put that into a paper and to isolate some of the issues. So we did the first two sets of experiments. The first one was running from the data transfer node. The data transfer node is a very powerful machine that is hanging off the edge of the network, so there are no firewalls that will cause any bottleneck for the transfers. So you are guaranteed to get maximum, well, at least very good speed. So, and also the data set, we'll left it at 4 gigs, 20 files each of 200 megabytes. But then what is in the blue boxes is what we changed. So we changed the data transfer tool used to send data and also the destination. So on the right, on the left hand side, the destinations, we consider four public cloud providers, Dropbox, Google Drive, Azure and AWS, and our local object store. We tested both downloads and uploads. to those run multiple experiments to reach of those destinations. And then we tried three tools, rclone and cyberduck, which are the last ones. Those are generic, meaning that you can use them to send data to any of them. So it is like a generic interface for you to move data between different cloud providers and your local machine. Then the first one, which is the provider CLI tool, is a tool that was developed for a particular cloud storage system. So you would expect that those are tailored to the particular cloud provider. And that was one of our hypotheses. So now let's take a look at some of the results. So I will show this heat map pointing some of the numbers. On the y-axis, we have the different cloud providers. On the x-axis, we have the tool that was used. And how dark, the darker the square, well, the better the throughput that we were able to get. So first of all, we found out that Dropbox was terribly bad to upload data. And the reason why it was so bad is because here in these red numbers, they were doing single thread transfer. So even though we were at the Deakin, which has 32 cores, it has a 40 gig line going out, it was just sending 16 megabits, megabyte chunks, waiting for a confirmation, and then again and again and again. So it was not taking advantage of the capabilities of the end system. So it yielded a very, very bad performance for both uploads and downloads using the CLM dedicated. And that was a surprise to us because it's not tailored for Dropbox. Like the generic tools outperformed them. As we can see here, for example, we got almost 2 orders of magnitude faster using tools that were not developed for Dropbox. So the first conclusion is that single thread transfers are just bad. Point that in fact we got 2 orders of magnitude faster while using the other tools. Another situation that we faced in the case of here in this 232 megabit per second is that out of the 10 transfers that we did, only 2 of them were successful, meaning that 8 of the transfers were incomplete, were partial. So it's not reliable to use, in this case, cyberduck to push data to Dropbox. And that behavior was happening because Dropbox was rejecting our uploads. So you would see the transfer was going on, the data was being sent out, but then at the end it said, like, I'm busy, I cannot accept this, retry later. So the data transfer tool needs to implement a backup mechanism. In cyberduck, the backup mechanism is just, it failed, I try again immediately, I try again, and it gives up very fast. In the case of rclone, it does an exponential backup. So it waits 1 second, if it fails, it also waits for 2 seconds and tries again, and so on and so forth. And even though the speed is not as, I mean, the throughput was not as magnificent, but it was reliable, and that's, rclone does that for every single cloud storage provider. So it was interesting to see that, and also that even though rclone is a generic tool, their backup mechanism and the possibility to customize it for your machine will let you yield a better performance. So you can see the right hand side is almost always darker than all the other columns. So at this point, well, we realized that, yeah, rclone, like, there's no point in comparing all the tools with and stick just to rclone transfers. And that's what we recommended to researchers using our system. So after that, we decided to compare the actual destinations, like how poor or good or bad they perform for transfers, both uploads and downloads. So unsurprisingly, our local object store was fast because, well, we have access to it and it's locally, so we don't have to go out. The cost, of course, is the maintenance, like how much space do we allocate for that object store to deal with all the data that is being pushed there. But then, when you compare the cloud provider, you get that AWS and Google Drive provide a better performance than Azure and Dropbox. But the values of the variations were smaller in Azure and Dropbox. So it all depends also in the, like, if you're fine having these variations, probably Google Drive and AWS would be enough for you. But if you count in your workflow for a steady, stable speed, maybe Azure and Dropbox will be better. Then we compare the direction. Is it upload faster than download? And in some cases it is. In the case on the right hand side, downloads were noticeably faster in the object store, in Google Drive and Dropbox. But in the case of AWS and Azure, both were about the same. So your workflow is just pushing data to Google Drive or to any cloud storage provider, probably AWS or Azure would be better. For downloading, it's probably better to use the Google Drive in this case. So out of those, all those parameters, so what we got was that rclone and Google Drive and AWS, as I said, were the best performing. So since Google Drive is free for UK students, so we decided to run experiments on Google Drive. But we have some caveats there because there is a limit of 750 gigs per day. You cannot push more than that to Google Drive per account. So we have to wait until the next day to run the subsequent set of experiments. So there is that problem. So now that we have those two things fixed, we decided to, okay, not only send data from the data transfer node, let's try to send data from one of our desktop machines in Hartlepool and one of the servers in here in Baxbury basement. And also, let's change the dataset characteristics. Let's change different files, different sizes. Let's change also the number of simultaneous transfers that we can use to send data to any of to Google Drive, and see how that affects the ultimate transfer. So, of course, by using this, the desktop and the file server, you would think, well, if they are on campus, they will get worse performance because, well, there are middle boxes, there are a lot of hops, there is a lot of latency, a lot of competing traffic, a lot of people watching Netflix, YouTube, and occupying all the links, right? So that's why, well, Dr. Griffin in previous talks have talked about this VIP lane system in which we can reroute data transfers or research or science flows into another campus core, which we call it VIP lane, right? So this green line means that you are able to maximize, probably you won't get the maximum theoretical speed, but you will be close to it. At least you will avoid these middle boxes, which are the ones that slow everything down, because they need to do some big packet inspection to your traffic. By going here, you just go straight to the redo. You have some hops, yes, but they won't be inspecting your traffic. So here are the characteristics of the nodes. And you can see this one is a very lightweight, normal desktop machine that you find in the lab. And this one is a beefier server with 10 gig interface. 48 cores, I don't know why it's better, but. And we run the experiments from all these three locations. So the thing that we found out that we think are relevant first is that using, like dividing your files into multiple chunks improves the performance, like but not significantly. Like here, this is the average. You can see for that this blue line is almost a straight line. I mean, it's a little bit increased, but not so much. Same with the gray one. And even here, you probably can tell that 16 megabyte chunk size is slightly faster than 32 megabytes. So, and 16 megabyte is the typical default in a lot of these applications. So probably, we didn't find any significance by modifying. But what we did find out is that the number of transfers is critical for moving big data sets. So in the case of the blue line, dotted line, is the maximum speed that we were able to get from our desktop machine, which is getting hard anymore, and that machine only had 4 ports. So increasing the number of parallel transfers to 8, 16, or 32 didn't have any impact because the machine was not as capable. But in the case of our server, the default parameter is 4 transfers, and we increased that to 32. We could even go up to 48, if I'm not wrong, and we were able to actually get 4 times faster speeds from here to Google Drive. Yeah.
Can multiple cores access the disk simultaneously?
Well, yeah. You need to have also a good fast operating system. I don't promise, but yeah, you can. What we have seen is that the more number of cores you have, the more simultaneous transfers you can send.
But they're sharing the same network interface, kind of.
Yes, they are. They are sharing the same network interface.
How does that work then? Why would multiple cores on one card be faster?
I didn't get into the details of how, but it's how those numbers were related. I didn't get into the monitoring of how each core was performing, but what we were seeing is that we were matching the number of transfers to the number of cores, it was getting the best performance. So it's like each core was spawning a separate thread for sending data out. That would still fit on the same network interface.
Yeah, I think the answer to the question is a single core cannot saturate the ability of the network interface card.
Yeah, right, it cannot. So, and also from the DPI, because of what I was saying, it's a four times improvement. So, to summarize, what we found out in this paper is that, or in these experiments, is that the tool that you use to move data matters. And of course, configuring to tailor your network in your system specification is what will yield the best performance. Also, we found that rclone provides a very good performance compared to providing specific tools. These provided specific tools, what they are just an interface to manage all the services for a particular cloud provider. So in the case, for example, of AWS, file transfer is one of the services, but you can do VM allocation, account management, all sort of other things. There are like more than 100. The backup mechanism in the data transfer tool is critical to react to the provider policies. So that's why we saw that rclone provides a better performance.
And all providers will accept rclone transfer?
Yes, actually, well, not. The list keeps increasing. I actually have the link here.
Clearly, it has its own protocol in the server.
You have to install it in the. It's actually all. Most of them are HTTP. Actually.
Yeah.
Yeah. Most of it is HTTP. Yeah, it's HTTP. So here's the list of all the. The list was like 10 when we run the experiments, but now a lot. They keep increasing the number of cloud storage systems that are supported. In the case of SFTP, it uses SSH, but most of them, the cloud ones, are all HTTP. You can download it.
So if I've got a website that is sitting somewhere on the cloud and it wants to upload data, cloud data, instead of just using a simple form with an upload file input tag, I could do something else which might be faster.
Yeah, you could. And a lot of researchers, what they do is they use this web based thing of drag and drop, right? To do drag and drop the files, and that's not always optimal. Yeah, with that one, you can programmatically add, get a better performance. So, yeah, and what's back to the. AWS and Google Drive provide a better performance, and matching the number of transfers to the number of cores will significantly improve the performance. And also, like it chunks, it will slightly improve the uploads of data, but not, it won't be a significant boost. So, yeah, that was the results that we found. And you know, if you have any other questions.
Maybe you can answer this. Most likely you can't. I'm trying to transfer a 20 gig file from Zeek, which is a machine which is on the fast lane, to the HSM machine, which is also on the fast lane.
Okay.
The effective speed is 60 megabits per second. 60 megabytes per second. Why is it so slow when all of the network between one and the other is at least a 10 gig line?
Well, I don't know for that particular case, but what we experienced from one customer in science, in the King Science, was it? They have this Mac with 64 gig, I don't know how many cores. It was very capable machine, but the TCP stack, it had the default parameters. So apparently, when they were pushing data to the object store, no, when they were downloading from the object store to the machine, at some point the TCP window was just full. So it would just advertise zero TCP window, like don't send me anything because I cannot process it anymore. So I don't know if probably any configuration of the TCP stack one of those endpoints, I don't know which one, is causing the slowdown.
Also, we found out that particular connection is asymmetrical. In other words, route coming back was taking another route.
Yes, yes, that's
because HSM side has a routing table set in such a way that it goes out normal.
Not going to the SDN.
Exactly. So,
yeah.
So
yeah, but there are.
I was thinking maybe the answer is I should not be using SCP, I should be using
Apple. Well, with SCP, that's just one transfer, right? With SCP, it's just one, it will generate just one flow.
Well, yeah, it's one flow.
And I would suggest probably splitting it into multiple files. And
yeah, for the particular application for which this was testing it. We might be able to split it, but we'd like to have something better than 68 megabits a second, megabytes a second. Okay, we'll figure it out.
Yeah.
Other questions?
I have a question, a small question. Here, why do you use the trunks? Because you need to upload files. Did you split the files into many trunks?
Yeah, well, what I know is that I can put those chunks in memory for faster uploading. So by default, what I understand is that they put 8 megabyte chunks in memory, and then they just, whenever it's possible, send them out. When you get the confirmation from the cloud storage provider that you can send more, they will keep sending those chunks. Instead of, the more that you get the size of the chunk, the more memory that you will use in your end system. And that probably will give you, when you have access, faster access to that data, then it's faster, but you do need more memory. But that's a parameter that you can do. It's just based on how capable is your machine.
Other questions?
Thank you very much.
Okay. So we now have talks scheduled for the rest of the semester, so I no longer need to beg you to put your names on the list. We have something for each of the